This is the top of the Great Pyramid of Giza. From a bird's eye view, the apex of the Great Pyramid spans an impressive 12 square meters. Historically, this summit was crowned with a capstone, often referred to as a pyramidion, but it has since disappeared. Ancient Egyptian documentation suggests that this capstone wasn't just ornamental, but was instrumental in harnessing the pyramid's intended purpose. Interestingly, by over 2,000 years ago, records indicate the pyramid was already missing its crowning stone. Originally, the pyramid was encased in gleaming white limestone, turning it into a radiant structure that could arguably be visible from great distances, possibly even from space. Legends suggest that the capstone might have been crafted from gold, fueling speculation that it could have been pilfered over the years. The absence of this critical component, believed to unlock the pyramid's true capabilities, adds another layer of enigma to this already mystifying monument.
The Sphinx actually says, "I have been here since the first time." Now, the word in ancient Egyptian for first time is Zep Tepi. And what they meant by this is the time when Osiris had come at the beginning of the civilization.
The Egyptians talk about a golden age. A golden age that existed 12,500 or so years ago. This is something that goes back at least 8,000 years before the current accepted chronology of Egypt. At that time, the gods mingled or walked with men.
Could this extraordinary monument be a remnant from a golden age when extraterrestrials coexisted with humans, as ancient astronaut theorists suggest? If so, does the Sphinx date back thousands of years before conventional scholars believe possible? Perhaps further clues of its true age can be found in the geological record of the Giza Plateau. Boston, Massachusetts. Geologist Dr. Robert Schock has studied the geological features of the Sphinx for over 20 years.
I looked specifically at the weathering and erosion on the body of the Sphinx, on the walls of the Sphinx enclosure. I saw weathering patterns that were not compatible with the Sahara conditions of the last 5,000 years. Here we have a photograph of the Sphinx on the left side. This is the rump of the Sphinx. This is the wall of the Sphinx enclosure. When you look at this, these are the lines of rock, or the strata, as we say geologically. You can see how they've been weathered out, sort of a rounded rolling profile. This is caused by rain beating down and running over the rock. And this was very evident to me as a geologist.
Honestly, when I first went to Egypt with John Anthony West, I thought, before I got off the plane, that this would be simple open and shut case. I would prove him wrong in the sense of his assertions that maybe the Sphinx was older. I had no doubt at the time that my colleagues in Egyptology must know what they're talking about. And all of that changed literally within 30, without exaggerating, 30 to 120 seconds of first seeing
really?
The Sphinx. Yeah, it really did.
What was your first impression?
Because my first impression of the Sphinx was, now that I saw it on the ground in person, there was something wrong with the Egyptological dating. Because when you look at the Sphinx as a geologist with a geological eye, this was not weathered by wind and sand. This was not desert erosion and weathering that I saw on the Sphinx. And it's that core body and the walls of the enclosure that show these ancient weathering, precipitation, erosional features that are incompatible with the last 5,000 years of climatic history on the eastern edge of the Sahara.
When you take a side view of the Great Sphinx of Giza, you'll notice that the head appears to be smaller than the body. There is a reason for this, but it's not what you might expect. See, while the majority of people believe it was simply intended to be disproportional, recent findings indicate that the Great Sphinx of Giza originally had a lion head, and when the ancient Egyptians discovered it, they recarved it into a pharaoh.
This is by far the most mysterious place we visited in Egypt, the Temple of Dendera. Not a lot of people choose to come here, so the temple is empty and you can really feel like you travel back in time. As soon as you walk in, you see that it's one of the best preserved temples. The level of detail is insane, and you'll get to see a rare fusion of Egyptian, Greek, and Roman art styles. The colors are also over 2,000 years old, but they look like they've been just painted yesterday. The whole experience is an adventure. The temple is a maze with countless beautiful decorated rooms. After you explore these, you'll find yourself climbing stairs and crawling underground to get to the crypts of the temple. In one of them, you'll even see the famous puzzling image that looks like a light bulb, but actually isn't. When you're done with the crypts, you can climb the melted staircase and go see the shrine of Hathor on the roof. If you're visiting Egypt, don't miss the temple at Dendera.
The Dendera Temple Complex stands on the west banks of the Nile River, located approximately 450 kilometers south of Cairo. This spectacular temple complex, dedicated to the goddess Hathor, is one of the best preserved temples in Egypt. The interior of the Temple of Hathor in the Dendera Complex is surprisingly intricate compared to its simple appearance and seems like a maze. The bright blue reliefs carved on the walls illustrate stories of the deities and religious messages. You can also see valuable reliefs in this temple, such as the relief of a constellation called the Dendera Zodiac and the Dendera light bulb, which looks like a modern light bulb. A carving on the exterior wall shows Cleopatra with Caesarion, who was her son with the Roman general Julius Caesar. This relic is a rare image of Cleopatra, as there are few historical records about her.